story over and over again, because I think a lot of this is, first of all, a lot of this material didn't exist 70 years ago. It's new, it's not quite the way you would normally do it. So the more experience you get with it, the better. So the first thing we talked about was the bit, the choice. If you have a choice, you have a bit. And if it's choice between two things, you have a bit. And if you don't have any choice, you don't have a bit. A one-it is nothing.
You don't have any choice.
Okay. Then we said, if you put bits together, like, again, the electric switch is a kind of great classic icon for a bit, because it can either be on or off. So if you put a bunch of bits together, and then we want to have a mathematical representation of those bits. And so what we do is we arbitrarily choose symbols 0 and 1. These are not counting numbers, they're just symbols. And what we do then is, if this switch is off, it's coded as a 0. You see this switch is on. Can everybody see that? See, the switch is on, so that gets coded as a 1. This switch is on, that's a 1, 1, 1, 0, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, and there is your string. And, for example, if we have a 3-bit string, it generates 8 different strings. So if we have 3 bits, from 3 bits we get to make 8 strings, and here are all the different combinations of the switches that make those 8 strings. And there aren't any more. That's all you can make with 3 bits. And then what that showed is that there's this thing I call an exponential explosion. It's that from so few bits, you get so many strings. So with n bits, you get 2 to the n strings. 2 to the n is much bigger than n. In fact, it can be enormously bigger than n. So information that is coding things into bits has this property, this exponential explosion property. And that's going to be a very big deal in today's lecture. The next thing after bits and strings that we talked about was code. What is code? Code is the thing that gives meaning to the bits. It encodes a thing. The thing can, in a way, be anything, into a bit string. So code encodes a thing into a bit string. For example, letters, words, the Bible, works of Shakespeare, photographs, movies, counting numbers, music, atomic and molecular configurations, including the periodic table, the genetic code, amino acids, blah, blah, blah. All these different things have an information content, and that information content is encoded in the string. And if a string happens to be the letter you wrote to somebody on your laptop or a text you sent to somebody, that's what is in the string. That's what the string, that's the meaning of that string. It's got your text in it. So the encoded thing gives a meaning to the string. So code's very important. It's part of what we call the semantics of the string. It's where the meaning comes from. So here's a typical string from 8 bits. Just one. How many strings are there of 8 bits? 2 to the...
To the 8.
Okay. And you might remember that it's 2. What is it?
2 to 6.
Tell me your name again.
Matthew? 2 to the N.
2 to the...
10.
10th? No.
The 11.
We have 8 bits. How many strings do you get from 8 bits? Yes? Stella?
Oh, no, I was reading the string.
Oh, well, how many bits do you get from 8? How many strings do you get from eight bits?
2 to the power of 8.
2 to the power of 8. So that's 2 multiplied by itself 8 times. So it's 256, is that right? Matthew, is that correct? All right. Now this string, this is one of those 256 strings. There's 255 more like this. This particular string in a particular code called the ASCII code, which is for coding letters and numbers into strings, is capital S, the uppercase S. That's what that is. Now this may seem like a burdensome exercise, but I want you to do it, if you don't mind. I want you to open the text file, as if you were going to send a text to somebody, or if you have your laptop, open, I don't know, in text edit, I think is the Macintosh text application, any kind of thing where you can write text. So, and we're probably going to be using Wolfram Alpha later, so you want to be ready with your laptops. But your phone will work fine for this. As if you're going to send a text to somebody. I just want you to write Springhouse School in with the capitalization there. So write it in. We're not going to send this. Well, you can send it to me if you want, but I just want you to. Okay, now you're seeing that on your screen, right? Okay, where are those letters coming from that are on the screen? Where are they?
They're in the, whatever it's called. The
chip.
Yes, that thing.
Right. So, in your phone or computer memory, there's a chip. And what it has, it doesn't have these big clunky switches. It has little transistor switches. Those microscopic transistor switches are on a chip. And that's where all the zero ones are. So Springhouse School in your phone looks like this. Now I can't write all the bits on the screen here. And the switches are little transistors that are on a circuit board, printed circuit board. So that's where Springhouse School is sitting in your phone. Behind the screen. Here is Springhouse School written out in 8-bit ASCII code. So this is what the usual computer storage of information is, ASCII storage for text. This, if you had your table of ASCII characters, I think you've used that. You wrote your name in ASCII. You can look it up. And you could actually then translate this string by looking at the first 8 bits and then the next 8 bits and the next 8 bits. Because the first one is the capital S we did in the previous slide. Question?
No, I think I'm...
Okay.
I was going to say, like, yeah, it's 8. Each 8 of them is one character.
Right. Okay, and this is Springhouse School in your brain's internal code. If you're looking at Springhouse School and reading it and thinking Springhouse School, where's that? What are these 100 billion neurons in your brain doing? They're working on that. So this same thing, the words Springhouse School, exist in all these different forms, and when it's in your brain, it's in, we don't know what the brain's internal code is. This is an area of current research. But somehow, the brain, with its magnificent architecture of neurons and nerves, it's full of electricity. It's very low voltage electricity, but your brain has got a bunch of switches in it. And those switches are lined up so that Springhouse School, when you look at it and think it, is in your brain. So that's where the thing is, this reality, which is a little phrase, Springhouse School, and it has all these different ways it can be encoded. Okay, so that is a little bit of a review of what we've done up to this point, and now we're going to move on to infinity. So if we have an infinite number of bits, that would mean we have an uncountable, we have a countable number of switches. We have, they just go on and on and on. If you give me a certain number of bits, I can add one more bit to it. So bits, an infinite number of bits make an infinite string. And it has some really interesting properties, and they can be useful. So that's why we're looking at them. Here's a typical one infinite string. It's a string of zeros and ones, and it goes on forever, as many counting numbers there are. Because each one of these slots is one of the bits, and it can either be the zero, in the zero state or the one state, either in the zero state or the one state. So each one of these has got a bit sitting behind it. What can that infinite string contain? It contained the information for all of Shakespeare's plays, every book ever written, every movie ever made, every song ever written, your DNA code, the DNA code of every human being, the DNA code of every animal on earth, and more, more, more. Such is the power of infinity. Is this realistic? Well, planet Earth and all of the creatures on it, all the oceans, mountains, all the atoms and molecules that make up all the stuff on planet Earth, contain approximately 10 to the 50 bits. That's a one with 50 zeros after it. That can make a pretty long string. Now, those 10 to the 50 bits are spread over multitudes of finite length strings. They're not infinitely long. Finite strings attached to the atoms, the molecules, the supermolecules, and larger scale structures of the Earth. That's where those bits are. And they're finite. But it's huge. They can contain the information, and now I'm writing this a little differently than I did in the first slide, all of Shakespeare's plays in the British Museum. Shakespeare's plays are in folios, and you can go and look at them in the British Museum. They're also published all over the world in books. All the books in the Library of Congress, every movie in print, every song in print, and its recordings in vinyl, CD, or memory chips in your phone, music played out of your phone, your DNA code, the DNA code of every animal on Earth, and more, more, more. Why? Why can we say that? Because all these things verifiably exist. They exist. Shakespeare play and the beauty, you can look at the play in the British Museum, it's there. And their information is encoded in the bonding structure and configuration of the atoms and molecules that compose paper, ink, CDs, computer chips, flesh and blood living creatures, and more. So think about that. I sent you this slide file, so you might want to look at that and think about it. Now, infinity is a useful approximation for enormously large but finite sets, like 10 to the 50 bits. Sometimes it's easier to think of it just might as well let it be infinite. Okay, the next concept we talked about last time was countable infinity. And I wrote here, it's all about countable. That's the key idea you have to get. And what does countable mean? It means the set can be put into pairing with the countable, with the numbers, the infinite set of natural numbers. So the infinite set of natural numbers, I think I talked about it as being the gold standard. It's the prototype. It's the reference point. If you're talking about infinity, it's not enough to talk about infinity. You have to say what kind of infinity it is. And countable is what counts. Countable counts. So what that means then is if you have an infinite string, you have some infinite string, how do you know if it's countable? To answer that question, you have to pair every element in that infinite string with one of these guys. And if you can do that, it's countable. And as the great example, we took the integers. The integers consist of all of the counting numbers and zero and the negative of all the counting numbers. So this is clearly an infinite set. And you might think, well, since it's got an infinite set here and another infinite set here plus a zero thrown in, is it bigger than just one of these by itself? And that was one of the surprising things about the behavior of infinite sets, of countable infinite sets, is it's the same size. So we proved that using what I call the cobweb proof. So here's our infinite set of one infinite set of integers of natural numbers here, another set of natural numbers here with negative signs, and stuck in the center is a zero. That's just one guy. And we showed that this can be paired with this. And the way you do it is you imagine this string, this is the gold standard, we're going to take it and we're going to stretch it out along this path and we're going to hit every element in this string of the integers. And I think you can see that however far you go, you're going to find, well, here, to start with, the zero goes with the one. Here's the one, we'll put that with the two. Here's minus one, we'll put that with three. Here's two, we'll put that with four, and so on. So we can find an element of the natural numbers. We can find a natural number that can hold hands with every one of these guys. And that means then that the integers are countable. What about two infinite strings of integers? Two copies of the integers. So here's one infinite string, and here's another one. If we have two copies, can we still, are those two, is that set of both of them? Is that countable? Well, the cobweb proof still works here. Here's the 0, 1, and it goes before it. But we code them a little differently now. We put the 0 with the 1, 1 with the 2. Now minus 1 goes with 3 from this string. Minus 1 from this string goes with 4. The 0 from the lower string goes with 5, and so on. But you can see that this path will hit every number in these two strings. Everyone will find a mate in the counting numbers. Same thing with three strings, no problem. And all the way up to a countably infinite number of copies of the integers. Now, so each one of these is an infinite string, and each one is just a copy of the other. And we have, they keep going on and on and on, countably. They're countable. So once again, the cobweb proof comes through. You can see that this cobweb will eventually get every number in this infinite set of sets. Any questions? Look okay? All right. Because now we're going to go, we essentially got to this point last time, but we're going to go on. So I guess we'll go on and we'll ask a lot more questions in the next session. I'm going to talk about one of the greatest discoveries in mathematics. It was done by a man named George Cantor. He lived from 1845 to 1916, and he made this discovery in the 1880s. And it was enormously controversial at the time. A lot of mathematicians said, this can't be. It's nonsense. And the Cantor discovery still bubbles. It's still a source of wonder and controversy and discussion. It has a lot of repercussions in probability theory and in randomness, what we mean by random numbers. Very important. And I think I mentioned in the note I sent to all of you that there are most, in fact, you could probably say, most theorems in mathematics require some preparation. Some, and in some cases, a lot of preparation. There's some theorems in mathematics, a very important one that was done by a man named Andrew Wiles about 10 years ago, showing that Fermat's last theorem was true. A proof of that, this was a theorem that x squared plus y squared equals c squared is only true if the a and the, if the x and the y and the z, x squared plus y squared equals z squared, only if the x, y, and z are integers. I think the proof took, in the first time he put it out, 150 pages. So, I mean, this is beyond most people's, you have to take his word for it, the mathematicians who checked it out. But that's not going to be true for our Cantor proof. This is a proof I think you will understand, and it will only take a couple of slides. So we said that n bits makes 2 to the n strings. That's the explosion, the exponential explosion. And that means, since it's finite, the set of all finite strings is countable. You can always take a finite string. It's like having a basket of apples or a basket of bits. So here's one basket of bits, and here's another basket of bits. Count them up. Which one has the greater number of bits? No problem, if it's finite. Where the trouble comes is if this basket can hold an infinite number of bits. Then there's trouble. So no problem for this. This is countable, definitely. But if we have an infinite number of bits, and I write it, it's not kind of cartoonish, it's sort of a cartoon, because as I told you, infinity is not a number, it's a concept, but if we have an infinite number of bits, it somehow means there's a 2 to the infinity number of strings. What could that possibly mean? Well, we can certainly talk about the set of all infinite strings, because we just had it back here. These strings are going out to infinity this way, and the number of them is going out to infinity this way. So we can certainly picture them, get a concept of them, and talk about them. But this worked for when these strings were integers. These strings were integers. So what if now these strings are simply infinite strings of zeros and ones? They're no longer the integers. They're just arbitrary infinite strings. Remember, the integers were kind of special. They were all the counting numbers. This is just an arbitrary string of bits. Now, is this, these guys spread to infinity, they're just spreading to infinity this way, spread to infinity that way. Is this countable? And that's where we get back to Cantor. Cantor's proof is basically that they are not countable. That's the final story. So of all of these different kinds of infinity that we got to see last time and for the first half of today, they were all countable, different ways. Integers, put them together, multiply them together. The only thing that doesn't work is if you exponentiate them, then you run into trouble. So what Cantor's proof is one of these proofs by contradiction. Now this is a important kind of proving style in mathematics. What you do is you assume that it's true. So Cantor says, let's assume that that big set is countable, that we can find a mate in the countable numbers for every one of those elements. Assume it's true. And what that does then, what Cantor showed, is it leads to a contradiction. So that means that since it leads to a contradiction, the contradiction meaning that there are strings that are infinite that can't be put in, tied together, hold hands with the natural numbers. And let's see how that goes. So the first thing we do is, as you just saw, we list all the strings, list them all out, assign a counting number to each string, and then show that the list does not include all the strings. They're not all there. And here's what it looks like. So I should try to use the laser pointer. So here's what we said we'd do. You take all the strings and you list them. So here's the, and you assign a number to them. So here's the counting number for the first string, the counting number for the second, and so on. And this is an infinite list. It keeps going. And the claim is that all the strings are in there. So here's where Cantor's ingenuity comes in. Cantor said, I'm going to make a string that's not in that set. So therefore, your assumption that you had all the, that these strings could all be countable, that is, linked up with the counting numbers, must have been false. So here's what he did. He said, I'm going to make a new string. So here's the new string I'm going to try to make down here. And here's how I'm going to make it. I go to the first string in the list, and I look at the first entry. It's a 1. So I see that I somehow 0. I have somehow copied the wrong string here. Well, that's good. That'll be instructive. What I want to do is make a new string that changes, that's this string. It's going to take the first digit from this string and flip it to a 0. And you see that's not happening here. I'm going to have to ask you in your minds to see that this has been flipped to a 0. What I want to do is then go to the second string and take its bit and flip it to a 1. In other words, I want to change the bits that are lying on the diagonal of every one of these strings to the opposite value. Can you follow that? I'm sorry I botched this up. But maybe that's just as useful. So we're trying to make a new string, and so the new string is actually running down this diagonal. The new string reads 1, 0, 0, 1, I'm sorry, the new string reads the opposite of these. It reads 0. You see a 1 here, it reads 0. You see a 0 here, flip it to 1, 1, 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 1. That's going to be the new string. So what I've done, what Cantor did, is change. He created a string. This is an infinitely long string because this goes on forever. By flipping the diagonal bit to a different value. And now you see the argument is going to be pretty straightforward. We got a new string here. It can't be the first string because its bit has been flipped. If I hadn't screwed it up, you would see that this is a 0. It can't be the second string because that one's been flipped as well. It can't be the third, the fourth, the fifth. In fact, it can't be any of them. That's it. This is one of the greatest theorems in mathematics. Can you see that? Do you get the idea? I'm sorry, I really botched this up, but the string, the new string we're trying to make a new string that can't be in this set. And we did it by making our new string by taking the first bit from the first string and flipping it, taking the second bit from the second string and flipping it. That's our second bit in the new string. The third bit, flip it, that's the new bit in our string. And our new string down here has every one of its bits. It can't match any of these strings in this set because there's always one thing that won't match. Can you ask a question? Yes. Jack.
Man, trying to figure out, so you can only, it only like works like this way, like it's not exactly true that it's countable when it's like that, like set up in that way. So I was trying to figure out like, okay, is it just in this way? Like the infinite amount and assigning a number to each string and that number.
Remember the rule.
Yeah.
Find a pair with the counting numbers. So here are the counting numbers running down here. And we paired it with every string. We said, that's what we mean to be countable. We put a string, this alleged set of strings is supposed to be countable. So we should be able to organize those strings in a way that we can pair them with the counting numbers running down here. Maybe I didn't make that clear enough.
A string of strings.
Yeah. This set is not one string. It's a set of strings. It's an infinite set of strings. And that's what we're asking about, is the countability of that set. We know that each one of these strings individually is countable. We did that with the integers, for example, where we found that we could count an individual string. But what about an infinite number of strings? So here's we're following the rule. Rule says pair the strings with the counting numbers, and then the mechanism of the proof, the way it works, what makes it work, is the construction of a new string. The assumption is every string is in this set of the set of infinite number of infinitely long strings. They're all there. And then the way the proof works is to say, I'm going to produce a string that I can prove is not there. It's not there. So therefore, the assumption that you could count them all is wrong. It's false. So,
can I share another way that I'm sort of thinking about?
Sure.
So the mechanism, if you imagine that doing that creates a string that is identical to your first string, because in your mechanism you've switched that one element in your first string, it can't be the first string if it happened to line up that way.
Right.
And you're doing that for every single string. There's at least one element that is different from that particular string.
Correct.
For every single string that's...
Right.
Yeah.
So that's the genius of the proof, is to figure out how to make a string that can't possibly be in this set. There it is. You've just been exposed to Cantor's theorem. So the conclusion is that there are strings missing from the countable set. So the assumption that the set of all strings is countable is false. Any questions? So it's pretty straightforward. Maybe it takes a little time for things to sort of percolate in, get your mind wrapped around it. The key things to hang on to is when we say countably infinite, it means pairing with the countable numbers, so you have to always keep that foremost. And we couldn't do that here. So this set is not countable. And
so
of all,
what's an application for that? When you say it's one of the greatest proofs of all time, what did it change?
Okay.
What has it been applied to?
Let's talk to the one. Let's talk about the one first of all. That's very practical. All of our arithmetic is done with the real numbers, what are called the real numbers. The real numbers are not countable. So what's a real number? Has anybody ever had that before or talked about it before? And I somehow have lost the really wonderful black marker. How did I do that? Oh, here it is. Okay. So,
that's right. So it would be,
so
it would include negatives, but just not like things like I.
It doesn't include anything that is I or multiple I.
Say that again, guys.
So real numbers are all numbers that you can
express
as a value. So things that aren't like, square roots and negatives. So all
square roots and negatives are real numbers. A real number is a number that has a decimal expansion. 1.23. In fact, all the real numbers actually can be mapped into the interval from 0 to 1. I know that may sound wild, but if we have 0.987321051602008 7, that's a number that's lying out here at 0.987. It's somewhere around here between 0 and 1. And the more digits I put on here, I'm going finer and finer and finer and finer. Are you with me on that? Getting it down finer and finer and finer. Now, we have infinite real numbers like 1/3. That's infinite. That decimal expansion is infinite. Those threes go on forever. You've seen that, right? Mm-hmm. Everybody clear on that? So this is 1/3 makes an infinite string, but it's quite countable actually, because you can reduce it to 1/3. But this string, let's go to the next step here. There are things like, what's 1/8? 0.12500, is that right? Can somebody check me? What's 1/8?
That's right.
Okay. So, this is infinite. This is repeating. This is non-repeating. But I'm alleging that this is non-repeating and it's non-terminating. Now, it would be great if you remembered all this stuff, but it's not that I want you to remember that. I'm trying to give a little insight of where Cantor's theorem comes back to play a role. So this is repeating. This is non-repeating. This is repeating. This is terminating. So this repeats, and this terminates after a while. And there are lots of other numbers that may go out and then repeat the same sequence over and over again. You've probably seen that in your calculator. But there are some numbers that do not repeat, like the square root of 2. The square root of 2 doesn't repeat, and it doesn't terminate. Cantor's discovery, but the square root of 2, because it has a pattern, it's not a repeating pattern, is actually not one of these uncomputable numbers, one of these uncountable numbers. The implications of Cantor are a whole universe of mathematics in itself. But one of the places that we use these kinds of infinite strings routinely, now in our calculators, they're always cut off, so they're always finite. So none of this quite applies, except to the extent that infinity is a kind of good approximation to very large numbers. Any other questions before we take a break and then go back to, we try to work on some problems. We're gonna work on the homework.
What did Cantor have to do with the real numbers? Cantor's proof? You said what the real numbers are, but what has Cantor's proof added?
Cantor's proof is the proof that this number that I drew that is non-repeating and non-terminating exists.
Exists.
Yeah. Okay. And you can't even actually write it down.
Right.
Because you'd have to write out an infinite number of digits. This is what leads to a lot of controversy. There's a school of mathematics that a man named Brouwer is very much, maybe this is the other name to think of when you think of Cantor, who said, I don't accept this kind of way of doing mathematics. Brouwer said, and he said, any proof that you're going to prove, that you're going to use to have credibility, has to have what he called constructability. What he meant by that, you have to actually construct the thing you're talking about. The Cantor proof is actually non-constructive because it begins with assumptions that all the numbers are in that set, and then it proves a contradiction. But it doesn't tell you how to construct anything. So Brouwer said the only thing that should be allowed in mathematics are constructible proofs, constructive proofs. And that means you actually have to show how you make the thing you're proving. And that means a lot of these proofs that depend on infinity are kind of ruled out of bounds. Another great mathematician of our time, other great mathematicians of our time, Roger Penrose, for example, says that the Brouwer criticism is too strong. He said, no, there's something interesting about infinity. There's something about it that we can't just rule it out. And this controversy actually still goes on. Did I answer your question?
Yeah.
Thank you.
That particular thing.
Yeah, that connection. Yeah, that's where. So the Cantor proof and the real numbers have a lot to do with each other. And the real numbers are basically all the numbers that you can make with a decimal expansion. And the rationals are included in there, but there's more numbers in the rationals because the square root of 2 is in there. The square root of 2, what is it, 1.41428, I don't know, is it something? It's a non-repeating, non-terminating decimal expansion, and it's not rational. So the real numbers include all the rationals, and as you recall in the homework problem, the rationals pretty much included all the whole numbers, it included all the negative and positives. So it looked like it covered all the bases, and in fact rational numbers do cover all the bases, and for most of the calculations that we do with your computers that have limited memory, These number strings are always cut off so that we're always kind of working with the rationals as rational approximations
to the square root of 2. There are good rational approximations to the square root of 2. And all of these pi is another irrational number. But I didn't want to cover, we don't want to get too far afield. That rational numbers is a whole other subject, and maybe just a little glimpse of it is that they, that you see that they don't have repeating or terminating decimal expansions. They go on and on and on. Okay, should we take a break? Or any question, another question? Jack, do you have another question?
Yeah.
So you're saying, so the real numbers do not include imaginary numbers. So that's what you're saying. Real numbers are everything except imaginary.
Yeah,
numbers.
The
square roots of negatives.
Yeah.
Like the square root of negative one is not a real number.
I can see why that is a little confusing, because of the word real. Well, the imaginary numbers are the same real numbers, but they have an I on them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But they're the same numbers. The only thing they have is an I multiplying them.
I guess it's a good way to think of it.
Yeah, I'm sorry, that real imaginary thing, that's not the distinction that we're talking about here. We're talking about the real numbers distinguished from the rationals and the whole numbers or the counting numbers.
All right. I think it's worth asking, is there any clear on what a rational number is?
That was the homework problem. Did everybody do the homework problem?
What is a rational number?
Can someone explain it to me? Because I don't know. And I wasn't here for the homework.
Actually, the homework problem was to show that the rational numbers were countable. A rational number is the ratio of two integers.
So
something over something else.
1/2.
3/2.
Yeah.
1.
So rational numbers. Yeah, I'm sorry. Maybe I should have been more sharp in the definition in the homework problem. Ratio of integers. Like 127 over 698, or 1 over 1. 1 over 1 is a rational number. 2 over 1 is a rational number. In fact, it's also whole. So the rational numbers include the whole numbers and all the fractions. All the fractions. But it does not include square root of 2.
Because any terminating decimal can be represented as a fraction. Right?
Yes. Yes. Terminating or repeating. What do you think, Gabby?
I'm not.
I'm just trying to remember your name. That's all.
You did a good job.
Stella. Any thoughts? Okay. Andrew, any thoughts? Okay, I hope you like the homework problem for this time. I'm trying to zero in on not making you think, I can't figure out what this is all about. But I think you'll find them a little more workable. So shall we take a break?
Yeah, sure.
What, about 5 minutes? Is that right? Okay. Okay, the first question was, what's the difference between the natural numbers and the integers? And this is really kind of an identification question. It's just learning the terminology. And I think everybody knew that. Everybody knew that the natural or the counting numbers are 1, 2, 3 to infinity. The integers add 0 and the negative of all the counting numbers, and that's the integers. Okay, what's the next question? Or we might have trouble.
The second question was...
Go ahead.
Why Why does this rule of thumb work? Quote, the logarithm of any number is approximately equal to the number of digits of the number.
Okay. Now, I have to apologize for this. I didn't say in base 10 or
okay.
base 2.
That's, okay, I was confused
and,
by that.
And that was my bad. Because, for example, suppose I have a number like that, and I say I want the log of that. Well, you have to say, well, what base do you want it in? Well, if I suppose I pick the base to be 126395, so the log of 126395 in base 126395 is what? What is the rule? It's the thing that you have to multiply the base by to make the number. Well, how many times should you bring up 126395? Just once. It's the log of anything to that anything's base is 1. Just like more familiar to you, perhaps, is log to base 2 of 2. It's 1. It's 2 to the what equals 2. What should that be? Well, it's x equals 1. So I didn't do well on this problem because I didn't say what base it should be. But I was thinking in my mind, it could be any base between 2 and 10, but it can't be base 126395 because then it wouldn't work. So it was confining the base to a rather narrow range, 0 to 10. And then if you have some big numbers, this rule of thumb works pretty well. And the reason it works pretty well is you can look at it for just straight powers of 10. For example, 10 to the fourth. Well, the log of 10 to the fourth in base 10 is what? Remember, the log pulls off the exponent? Log pulls off the exponent. The log of the number is the thing that tells you how many times to multiply the base to get the number. So the base is 10, so multiply it 4 times. So did anybody look at logarithms on Khan Academy? Good, good. So does this make sense to you?
Yes.
Okay. So please do look at logarithms on Khan Academy. So that the reason that this works pretty well is that this is pretty much 10 to the fourth is equal to 10,000, and it has 5 digits. Well, you can say, well, you didn't get the right answer, you got 4. Well, this is where it's probably the worst, is up at when you have 10 to the fourth or 10 to the third, rather than 2 or 7 times 10 to the third or 3 times 10 to the third. That's where it gives the poorest result. But it gives the best result, or it gives a fair approximation, especially on really large numbers. And if you're off by 1, that's not so bad if you're talking about 20 digits, like the number of bits on the earth, 10 to the 50. If you wanted to guess the logarithm of that number as 49 or 50, 49 or 50 is pretty close. But it's a nice rule of thumb to remember sometimes. And it also gives you an appreciation of how small logarithms are. Huge, huge number, take its log, it's a small number. Okay, what's the next question? Camille, can you have it?
I don't have it.
Oh, you don't have it? Yasha?
Yeah, it's really long compared.
Okay, speak up.
Consider the 10 numerals 0, 1, 2, 3, okay. Yeah. 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, and the operators addition, multiplication, and exponential. Write a string no longer than 5 characters drawn from above 13 characters. Note that the arithmetic operators must be written between numbers, as in 5 plus 6 or 3 times 4. Choose your characters so as to code the largest number you can create in 5 characters. For example, 6 times 5 plus 9 is a valid 5 character string, and 6 times 5 plus 9 equals 39. You can surely do better. Note that a Google, which is 10 to the power of 100, requires 6 characters. Be prepared to present your solution to the class.
Okay. Any offers? Matthew, you got an offering? Andrew? Can you do better than 39?
Yes.
Okay.
9 to the power of 100.
Okay, good. We're rolling now. I guess I have to write it that way. With the 5 characters. So it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 characters, 9 to the power of 100. That's a pretty big number. Any other? Adrian, you got any ideas?
I did 99 to the power of 99.
That's pretty good, too. Which one's bigger?
Well, I have a top one.
It's a little hard. A little hard to tell exactly. But.
I think the top one could be bigger if you did 9 to the power of 999.
That would make more sense.
Okay. Well, who's talking? Andrew?
Me, yes. Yeah,
I didn't hear you.
I'm just talking to myself.
Oh, okay. Go ahead, Yasha.
I did
9 to the power of 999. Did you get any answer from Wolfram Alpha on that? Probably not. Don't bother. It'll blow the roof off. Okay. Any other? Now, let's look at what happened here. First of all, people didn't want to use plus. It's too weak. And you didn't want to use times. You said, no, I don't like those. You went for that one. You went for exponentiation. You like exponential explosions. Okay. And you picked the biggest numeral, 99999. Can anything in 5 characters be bigger than that?
If you weren't...
I just want to say one thing here, and this happens a lot in when there's a lot unsaid that you're supposed to assume. Some people, I can't remember who now, but I think it was Marin. Are you here, Marin? I think you might have assumed that you couldn't use the number twice because you used 9876, and that was a perfectly good interpretation.
I didn't assume that. I just wanted to do that.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Well, Because it, I didn't say you can only use the numerals once. That would be another constraint. And so you use 9, 8, 7, 6. You didn't repeat what you were using. Okay, but you went for the biggest numeral and you went for the strongest operator. But there is, you can do a little better. And here, sometimes it's useful to use parentheses. I mean, it's not, this is, that's not the important point I'm making here. Uh-oh. Do you get it? So this is 9 to the 9 to the 9.
9 to the 9 is just 81, which is not as big as 9 to 9.
9 squared is 81.
9 squared is 81.
Good point. I was like...
No, 9 to the 9 is a big guy. That's a big thing.
Right. I was like, oh, I could do that. But I was like, oh, but that wouldn't be... That's a good point. I didn't...
That's okay. That's all this. Right. We, okay. When we're learning algebra and when we're learning these things, we often, you know, make mistakes. I mean, I still make mistakes all the time. So it's nothing wrong with making mistakes. So this is probably the best you can do, as far as I know. Should we go to the next one? So did anybody, I don't think anybody wrote, I don't understand what this is about, but I think on the next one, what, can you read the next one, Yasha?
Yeah. A rational number is a ratio of integers such as 5 over 1, 1 half, or negative 256 over 3,750, and includes fractions as well as whole numbers. Since the integers are countably infinite, it's clear the rationals are infinite. Prove the rationals are countably infinite. There are no more rational fractions than there are natural numbers or integers. They are all countably infinite. You can research this on the internet. Thus, to our list, the countably infinite numbers, we can add the rational numbers, that multitude of fractions included.
Okay, and several of you went to the internet and found some pretty good solutions to that. I think several of you might have found this is sort of like the cobweb proof, only it's not quite the cobweb, but it's in the same spirit of you put all your denominators running along here. And you put all your numerators running along here so that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. And you can see this labels a grid. So every point in this grid has a, I just pick a point, like right here. This point has a denominator, it has a denominator of 3 and a numerator of 2. And so let's just go down this line here. So this is the denominator, this is the numerator. These are the numerators, those are the denominators. So the numerator is 1. The denominator is 1. This is 1 over 1. The numerator is 1. The denominator is 2. This is 1 over 2. This is 1 over 3. This is 1 over 4. And now here, the numerator is now 2. Denominator is 1. Numerator is 2. Denominator is 2. So you can fill out this chart. Here's numerator is 3, denominator is 1, numerator is still 3, denominator is 2, numerator is still 3, denominator is still 3, denominator is 4, numerator is 3. So all of these numerators are from the numerator label, and then you just ring in the denominators. So you'll fill out this whole table. And that table will have all of the rational fractions. It goes on for infinitely far. And then the proof that this is countable is very much in the spirit of the cobweb proof. So you're going to take a path through here, for example, like so. So the web is going to go on these diagonal lines. And there's a beautiful chart that's on the internet, and several of you got it, found it. I should give you the URL for it. But if you look in Wikipedia, for example, under rational, I'm not sure exactly where that beautiful figure is, but you can find it. So there's a proof that basically uses the cobweb idea that you're going to stretch the countable numbers, and they're going to flow all through this whole two-dimensional chart and eventually hit every rational number. Okay, any question about that? Is the ventilation in here good? It seems awfully stuffy. How do you ventilate this room? Need some fresh air. What's the next question?
Last question.
Okay.
Thought question. We can express the number 10 to the power of 100, which has 101 digits, with a mere 6 characters above. 3 zeros, 2 ones, and a figure for the exponent. But consider the equally long 101 digit number. I'm not going to read it off. In which we seem to have to write out every digit. What do you think makes the difference? Hint, think about strings having a property of complexity which can be measured by compressibility. Simple numbers such as 1 with 100 zeros following are compressible from 101 digits down to 6. But complex numbers like the second can't be compressed. Incompressible strings are also intimately related to random strings. There's no order or pattern in the digits, as there is for a 1 with 100 zeros. The second string was in fact generated by a random number generator.
So, actually I got it. So this is 100 zeros. And this is 100 digits also. So both of these strings are the same length. The way I drew it, the way I wrote it out, it's not very clear. Here, let's do it this way. There. So 1 with 100 zeros, and this string with, I guess we have to have 101 to make them the same. So the lengths of these two strings are the same. But your intuition tells you there's something very different about these strings. There's something that's not comparable in them. And it's not anything we've talked about. It's not about infinity. It's really about that strings have another property that you can talk about without knowing what their meaning is. remember, if you have a meaning for a string, that tells you a lot. I mean, but what can you say about strings, setting aside their meanings? Well, one of the things we can talk about is how long they are. And that's pretty much about it. We can talk about whether they're countable, except for one new concept. And we're not going to actually study this. I just would be happy to call your attention to it, have you think about it, because you can see it. The concept is complexity. This string is not complex. It's simple. But this string is complex. So there's another property of strings, and it's a very big subject in mathematics today, especially. Again, it's one of these concepts that didn't exist 70 years ago. But you intuitively see it. Yasha, do you have your answer to the question? Do you have it with you? Or? I thought it was a pretty good answer, so why don't you read it, if you can get it up.
Okay, I just said that the difference...
Okay, speak loudly.
The difference is that with the first number, you would only be using 1 and 0 if you were to write it all out, and it would be clear, there would be a clear pattern. Whereas with the second number, you have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9, and no obvious pattern. Where there's less numbers and a more distinct pattern, you can mush them together more easily.
Great word, mush. Okay. Okay. Anything you could say about that? And I agree that maybe these thought questions and essay questions seem to be a little bit, throw you a little bit. But anything along those lines of anything you could point out that says these are different. I can't put my fingers on it exactly, but they're different. And that difference, I'll just give you the word to keep your eye out for in the future, is complexity. Things are complex, and some things are simple. And it doesn't necessarily have to do with how long they are or how big they are. It has to do with how they're put together. They're put together in a complicated way. They're complex. This string is put together in a complicated way. This one is put together in a really simple way. Okay, do we have any other questions? Oh, there is something I wanted to mention. If I can remember it. I think it was brought up by Alex. Maybe you can help me remember it. There was the whole thing about base 10. I wanted to get that straightened out. Well, this is from a slightly earlier time, but one of the things we like to really keep straight is this exponential explosion. So if we have something simple, like, so here we have like n, like the number of bits in a string. And here we have 2 to the n. So this is a plot. This is how the number of strings grows with bits, the number of bits. So what does it look like if you have 1 bit, you have 2 strings, so there's a point here, and then this grows exponentially. Actually, if we have 0 strings, we can't really talk about that, but if we have 0 strings, 2 to the 0 is 1. So this is here, So an exponential curve rises very fast, and it rises faster than all the other curves. Like, suppose it was just going to be proportional to the number of bits. Well, that would be a straight line if strings were proportional to the number of bits, but they're not. They grow much faster. And sometimes we got a little confused and you thought they grew like the square. And so the square grows kind of fast too, but it's nowhere near as fast as exponential. So exponential is the fastest growing function. Well, there are other functions that can grow, but they're slightly more pathological. No, I was going to say, well, if there aren't any other questions, I think we're going to be done for today. There's a new self-exam homework assignment, and have a look at that. I think this is going to go a little more smoothly than some of the others, and some of them, you might find them interesting. In the homework assignment, please, all of you, look at the homework assignment, because the first problem, so to speak, is not a problem at all. It's a direction to a video, a YouTube video, that you should all look at. The problem, I said, write a three-sentence review if you want to. You don't have to write a review, I guess, if you don't want to. But I think this is really one of the best videos I've seen in explaining Cantor's theorem. And it's by a young woman named Vi Hart, and she's as entertaining as she is sharp. So I think you should all look at that. You'll find it a pleasure to look at. And that's in the homework. That's the first problem in the homework. So that's it. Thank you. See you next week. Oh, just one last thing. We will start working on mathematics and art next week. So we're going to... What's that?
Like sacred geometry. It's not like art. Anyway.
We're going to look at how mathematics makes visual things.